is it not written in your law that ye are gods? You understand what I'm saying? So it just depends on what level you own based on, whether you're human or whether you're immortal.
At ease. It's your boy, Solo Moore. The other day, I made a video, and it was entitled, How I Cracked Life's Code, right? Now, in this video, I talked about how I separated myself from myself, right? And observed my life from the third person point of view. And just observed pretty much the things that were taking place before my life, you know, were taking spikes over the last, 20, 25 years, right? But what surprised me is that didn't nobody ask the question, right? Nobody said, well, Soul, if you identified the things that were taking place before your life shot up at those three, those three periods in your life, then surely goodness and mercy, you were able to observe the things that were bringing you back down, right? Today, brothers, I want to talk to you about why in 2021, I am selling everything I own and will soon be practicing minimalism. You know, brothers, the one thing I've observed over the last, 4 or 5 years of my life is that I was just as happy, at the quote unquote top as I was at the quote unquote bottom, right? Even going back to my very first vehicle, man, I believe I was 15 years old, had a Chevy Blazer. It was an 87, black, spokes, hydraulics, it was dope, right? I was just as happy with that vehicle as I am with the vehicle that I purchased last, right? When I think about getting my first apartment back when I was, I believe, 17 years old. I had a one-bedroom apartment, man. It was about 750 square feet, Longview, Texas, East Monroe, right? I was just as happy then as I am living in the place that I'm living now, right? Even thinking back to, back in the days when everybody was rocking the Nike Cortez, the gangster Nikes, right? I was just as happy rocking those as I am rocking a pair of Yeezys, right? See, the thing is, I realized later in my life, just a few short years ago, that my level of happiness, that I've already peaked that out. I've already maxed that out. It doesn't matter what situation I find myself in, I can never be more happier than I am right now, right? Now, I could have dopamine spikes, of course, right? If I walked outside and in my driveway, there's a Bugatti Veyron with a bow on it with my name on it, of course I'm going to be lit. Of course I'm going to be all over the place. My dopamine is going to be rushing. But I won't be any more happier than I am before I walk outside. You know what I'm saying? See, the pattern that I had observed, the thing that was taking place just before my life was dropping off those three times I spoke about, right? I noticed that there was a high level of materialism. I observed that there was a high level of consumerism. The common denominator that was taking place in each of those situations, right, over the course of all those years, the common denominator was, in each situation, I had a garage full of toys, meaning motorcycle, four-wheelers, right, and I had a driveway full of cars. Now this is what I'm not saying, right? What I'm not saying is that having things is bad, because it's not. I believe, people work hard, people manifest things, and accumulating things, it is a blessing, right? I'm not saying that it's not a blessing. But the thing that most people are unaware of is that these things come with a price that most people have no clue exists. These things require, certain amounts of energy from us. You know, on Patreon, on my Patreon channel, I was just talking about the rich young ruler in the Bible, right? And for y'all that aren't familiar with the rich young ruler, you know, rich young ruler came to the prophet and his crew, and he was like, hey, you know what? I want to be down with your crew. You know, I want to roll with y'all, right? And it said that Jesus turned to him and said, all right, well, you know, well, you got to move like this, and you got to move like that if you want to be down with us. And it said that the rich young ruler said, well, hey, man, you know, I'm not out robbing no banks, man. I'm feeding the poor, man. I'm helping the blind walk across the street. I'm doing all these good things that you're talking about, right? And it said the prophet said, all right, cool, cool. Well, if you want to roll with us, go and sell or give away everything that you have, right? And it said the rich young ruler just put his head down and turned and walked away because he knew he couldn't separate himself from his worldly possessions, right? Now, the thing that I misunderstood from that story or the thing that I just really didn't catch was this, right? See, I thought the whole point of that story was just to inform us to never let worldly possessions, you know, get in the way of higher levels of understanding, right? Or walking the path, or however you want to call it, right? But it was more than that. What the messenger was saying to the rich young ruler was not that, hey man, these things that you own, they're bad. He wasn't saying that, right? What he was saying is, like brother, if you want to move how we move, you know, in other words, if you want to go to the depths of where we go, then you have to be in position where you don't have these worldly things pulling at your energy, right? But because it's going to require all that to move like we move, right? Now, this is the other thing that the rich young ruler didn't understand. And this is also what I've just recently in my life understood, right? See, it seems like the rich young ruler would have been getting rid of all these things that he had worked for. But in reality, he would have been gaining access to much more than that, right? And this is why I say this, guys. You know, the more my mentality is to release the things in my life, the more downloads or the more information or the more spiritual knowledge I obtain. You know, just yesterday, I decided to delete my Instagram channel, right? Personally, it was doing nothing but sucking the life out of me, right? And I can tell you, within just an hour or two of deleting that channel, it seemed like I'd gained access to another brain or something, man. Just I started having all these thoughts, man. You know, when I get out and I do my exercise, whether I'm jogging, whether I'm walking, you know, now I'm exercising more, you know, without music. And I'm kind of just listening to the world around me. And just by me denying that part of myself, I'm hearing more things from a higher level of consciousness, right? So the thing is, it's not about really losing something. It's about gaining everything. What I've noticed is, you know, the more money I accumulate, it seems like the less desire I have to get things, right? Now what's weird is the less desire I have to get things, the more ideas come to my mind to make more money. You know, just the thought of getting rid of everything I own, you know, I can feel my life going from, you know, having six-figure years to in the future having seven-figure years, right? Because when you think about it, it's simply a distribution of power. Everybody gets the exact same amount of power. It just depends on how you want to ration it. You know, you can ration it towards your purpose and assist in changing the world. Or you can have a driveway full of cutlasses. You know what I'm saying? It's simply a distribution of power, right? You know, I remember, you know, when I was young, you know, growing up 20s and maybe early 30s, when I thought about people being successful, you know, I looked at the people who were, you know, who had the big chains and the big cars and the big homes and the watches and all this stuff, right? But as I got older, you know, and as I started, you know, putting a few coins in the bank myself, you know, I lost interest in that, right? You know, the people who started intriguing me then, you know, were the people who had the bag, but didn't have to show it, right? there was something in me that was just intrigued by people like that. I was like, what is it that they know that make them move the way they move, right? And it goes back to what I read in my last video. And this is slowly becoming, you know, my second favorite quote of all times, right? And again, it's in the Master Key System by Charles Hanna. And it says, the race has usually been for money and other mere symbols of power. But with an understanding of true source of power, we can afford to ignore the symbols. The man with the large bank account finds it unnecessary to load his pockets down with gold. So with the man who has found the true source of power, he is no longer interested in its shams or pretensions. In other words, the ones who have the bag have absolutely no reason to go out and show that they have the bag because they are the bag. In a nutshell, brothers, what we have to do as men, you know, that want to succeed, you know, we first have to analyze ourselves, right? And what I mean by that is, you know, separate ourselves from ourselves and observe us from the third person point of view, right? And once we establish that, we need to go back into ourselves and create the highest version of ourselves, right? Now that's going to look different for everybody. You know, for me, you know, there's nothing more that I desire more than knowledge and power itself. You know what I'm saying? You know, all I need is a shack in the middle of the woods. You know, you give me a laptop, you give me a camera, give me a little bit of Wi-Fi, and brothers, I'm good, right? You know, at this point in my life, you know, I see absolutely no reason to distribute power to anything or any other person outside of myself. My grandmother had a house in a small town called Gilmer, Texas, in a community called Lake Providence, right? And her house was at the bottom of two hills, right? Now, this is what I remember. I can remember even when I was that young, 3, 4, 5 years old, going to my grandmother's house. You know, I can remember my grandmother's house already being an old house. You know, I don't know what year it was built, you know, just a regular wood frame, older style house. I don't know what year it was built, but it was already old when I was 3, 4 years old. You know, I can remember, you know, the sound of the front door opening, the little screen door had, you know, a certain little squeak. You know, there were certain, you know, creaks in the floor. You know, when you walk, you hear certain noises. It was just an older house, still in fair condition, but it was older. Now, the thing is, you know, after my grandmother moved, you know, and other family members moved in there over the years, you know, and you know, we always had family in there, right? And even up until just a few years ago, the last time I went in there, you know, that house was still in the exact same condition, the same creaks, you know, the walls, same condition, the screen door still had the same little, and I didn't think about it, right? It just seemed normal that even, you know, in an additional, you know, what, I was in my 30s then, you know, from 3 or 4 years old up until my 30s, that house had just continued to stay in the same condition. Didn't think nothing of it, right? Until about a year ago, give or take, right? And I'm driving to Keller, Texas, up here in Dallas, Fort Worth, right? I'm driving to see a buddy, I was driving to see a guy that was selling something that I was interested in. I was getting ready to buy something from him, right? And I'm going out through Keller, Texas, and if y'all are familiar with Keller, Keller has some nice homes in it. And I'm going in this, you know, this suburb area, nice homes. And then there's this area where it's just kind of like nothing but trees. And then there's this road that was to my left, and there was just this long straightaway. And on both sides of the road, there were nothing but houses that nobody lived in. Like large, and I would say, you know, new style homes that nobody lived in. And I looked down it, and it looked like a ghost town. Grass was growing up, you know, they were brick, they were complete, but nobody was living in it, right? So I was like, man, that just looks weird. It looks like a studio, like somebody was filming a movie down there or something, right? So I go and talk to the guy, and, you know, and we handle our business or whatever. And I asked the guy, I said, well, what's the deal with this neighborhood up the road, man? Like, what, like, it looks crazy. He said, yeah, man, there were some developers that came in, you know, just like 2 years ago. and started building these homes. He said, I don't know if they ran into financial trouble. I don't know if they had some kind of legal issue. He said, they just up and left. No realtors trying to sell the homes. The home just been sitting there, stagnant, right? And I was like, that's crazy. And I'm thinking in my mind, all the money that was probably lost, right? So on my way back out, man, I'm headed back home. I turn down this road, right? And I'm driving and I'm looking at these houses. And I'm saying, this guy told me that these houses, you know, were built just like, you know, a year and a half, 2 years ago, you know, when a developer moved in. I said, but man, these houses look like 50 or 60 years old. You know, so I park, man, and I go in one, because I think most of them were still unlocked. Doors up, they were brick, they're just unlocked, right? And I walk in, man, and these houses were nice, right? Wood floors, nice wood cabinets. And I'm looking at the cabinets, man, and it looked like the wood was just dried up. It looked like this stuff had been here, man, maybe 50 or 60 years. You know, I'm looking at the hardwood floors, man, and they're separating, there's cracks. I'm just looking at the house and the walls, and man, this house, even though, you know, I could tell by design that it was new, the newer style design, but this house looked like and felt like it was at least 60 or 70 years old, right? And I'm telling you, man, something this minor, man, just messed with my mind. So I'm driving home and I'm like, how in the hell, like what? Like, first I'm thinking about why they left, but then I'm thinking about the condition, right? And then something just hit me, right? I said, I get it now, man. And it went back to the rich young ruler. It went back to what the messenger was telling him, right? So when the messenger was saying, hey, you know, you need to get rid of all these things and then you can roll with us, you know, you can follow me. He wasn't really saying that, you know, you need to prove yourself that you can, you know, separate yourself from these things. What he was saying was, you know, these worldly things, they aren't bad. They're blessings, right? But you have to understand this. You have to understand these worldly things, whether it's a house, whether it's a car, whether it's a boat, whether it's anything that's worldly that we can attain. You have to understand that for these things to survive, they're living off of your life force.